tonight we're going to continue on with our study through the book of Acts. I'm not sure how many weeks actually we've been doing this now. It's quite a few. But we're in Acts chapter 17 tonight, so if you'd like to turn to chapter 17, that would be just great. I want to encourage you to bring your Bibles and to try and follow what is being read and said. Okay, so verse number 1. When Paul and his companions had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. As was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. "This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah," he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. But other Jews were jealous, so they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some other believers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decrees, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus." And when they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others post bond and let them go. And as soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the Scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. And as a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. But when the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God at Berea, some of them went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The believers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. And we just ask that the Lord would bless his word, his living word to us tonight. And let's just pray. Father, as we come to you this evening and we are reading from no ordinary book, we are reading from the Scriptures, your living word, God breathed. And we just pray, Lord, that your Spirit would take up your word and speak it into our hearts and lives tonight. We're conscious that the events that we've read of took place roughly 2,000 years ago. But Lord, we pray that the important lessons that we read as they experienced so many trials and difficulties and challenges as they witnessed for you, we pray, Lord, that the experience of their faithfulness and their lives and the way that they went about their mission work, that it would really speak into our hearts today and encourage us and renew our passion for you. So, Lord, we come and just simply ask that you would open our eyes to see what the Spirit has to say to the church today. And it's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Well, can I ask for the map to go up, please? If we can find the map. I just want to show you where we're journeying. There we go. I hope you can see it. Last week we come as far as Philippi. That's Philippi there where the red dot is. In what we'd call northern Greece today, it's called Macedonia in the Bible. And so we're going to journey from Philippi down through Amphipolis in Apollonia. And we're going to Thessalonica. Right, it's not, is it named? Yes, it is. There it is. And that's it there. And then after that, we're going to Berea. So the distance from Philippi to Thessalonica would be 100 miles. And it's another 20 or 30 miles on down the road to Berea. So that's where we are going tonight. So journey with me, please. And I want to, first of all, to encourage you to use your imagination and try and think of yourself as being part of the mission team, you know, as they're traveling with Paul on this pioneering outreach work of taking the gospel to where it had never been before. And as they thought back, they probably had happy memories, but they also had memories of great difficulty and challenge and opposition wherever they went. And so I wonder how you would feel if you were traveling with them to yet more new places. Would your heart be filled with fear? Or would it be filled with joy and excitement at what God was going to do? Well, I think for Paul and Silas and Timothy and Luke, who's the writer of the book of Acts, I think probably that their excitement overcame their fear. Yeah. And as God calls us all to be witnesses for him, I hope we get a sense of excitement and privilege that God calls us to serve him. So that's what we're going to do. We're going on this journey along the Macedonian coastline. And they pass through, we are told, Amphipolis and Apollonia. Now, when I read this, I thought, well, why? Why did they pass through these places? Why did they not stop? And why did they not preach in these towns? And I came up with several possible answers. One of them was that the Spirit of God told them that they were to keep going because they were very sensitive to how the Spirit of the Lord was leading them. And so it may well have been that the sense that the Lord was saying, don't stop here, keep on going to Thessalonica. Another possibility is that they were distancing themselves from what had happened at Philippi and trying to get as far along the road as possible, so that they weren't going to be hounded by these Jews that were constantly after them. And another possibility is that there may well not have been any Jewish synagogues in Apollonia and Amphipolis, because Paul loved to go and visit the Jews first of all. He wanted to go there. He wanted to go to the synagogues first and tell the Jews, his brothers, about the Lord Jesus, that he was the Messiah that was promised in the Old Testament. But anyway, we are told that they didn't stop, that they passed through, and giving their citizens, I suppose, only the briefest opportunity to chat to them and hear about the Lord Jesus Christ and to respond to the gospel. We don't know if anyone there responded to the gospel or not. But I stopped for a moment as I was preparing for tonight, and I thought about this, about passing through. Yeah, these believers who were just passing through. I don't know whether it gave anybody the opportunity to hear the gospel. But I thought about Jesus and how we're told in the Gospels that sometimes Jesus didn't stop in places, but he just passed through. And one of these places in particular was Jericho, as the Lord Jesus was making his final journey up to Jerusalem and to go to the cross and then to rise from the dead. But we are told that he passed through Jericho. And there were two people there in particular who grabbed the opportunity for Jesus to come and talk to them. Well, one of them did at least, and the other one didn't. But Jesus saw him. Do you remember Zacchaeus? Up in the tree, and he's watching Jesus, this little man, and he'd climbed up the tree like a monkey, and he was looking down in this vast crowd of people who by this time were following Jesus. And perhaps he was hiding away there because he wasn't popular, because he was a tax man. He was one of these hated tax men who gathered the taxes from the Jews for the Romans and then kept a little or sometimes quite a lot for themselves and put it in their own pocket. But he's up there in that tree and Jesus comes along and he pauses. And he looks up into that sycamore tree. And we've got a neighbour who's got a sycamore tree in his garden, and in the summertime it's full of leaves. It's very difficult to see actually what's inside the tree. But Jesus saw Zacchaeus there. And he said, Zacchaeus, come down. Come on down out of that tree, because I want to go to your house for my tea. And the Lord Jesus went to Zacchaeus, to his home, and they had a chat. It ended up in Zacchaeus giving his life and his heart to the Lord Jesus and becoming a follower of Jesus. And many people that were there got the surprise of their lives. First of all, that Jesus might be interested in someone like Zacchaeus. But also that many of them received a windfall when he paid back what he had stolen. You see, when we come to faith in Jesus, our lives get changed. And sometimes that part of that journey is to pay back what we have taken away. And that's what Zacchaeus did. And then they journeyed on through Jericho and they're just about to leave. And then there's a voice cries out from somewhere in the crowd, Jesus, have mercy on me. Jesus, have mercy on me. And the Lord Jesus is encouraged not to stop and not to be bothered by whoever's shouting at him. And it turns out to be a blind man who's a beggar. And his name is Bartimaeus. He would have been, I think, a pitiful sight for anyone to see. And he cries out again and again, Jesus, have mercy on me. Son of David, have mercy on me. And the Lord Jesus comes to him and he says to him these wonderful words, what do you want me to do for you? And he says, I want to receive my sight. And that day he received his sight and he began to follow Jesus. Jesus was passing by. You know, I think it's really important when we sense that Jesus is around that we grab hold of the opportunities and we hear what God is saying into our hearts and into our lives and we don't let Jesus pass us by. And every time we come together to worship God and every time we read his word, I think God is really wanting to speak into our hearts and into our lives. Don't switch off when you come to services, but really have a hunger just to find out what God might be saying to you. Don't let Jesus pass by. Yeah. It made me think, actually, of an old hymn that we used to sing. V's nodding because she probably knows the song that I'm thinking about. And so I printed it off the internet. I don't know when we last sang it. I'm not gonna sing it to you tonight. But it's this song, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Saviour. It was written by a very well-known lady songwriter in the 19th century, Fanny Crosby. I think she wrote over 1,000 hymns. She was blind. Maybe that, you know, heightened her sense of presence of God in her life. And this is one of our hymns. Pass me not, O gentle Saviour, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Saviour, Saviour, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. And maybe you're here tonight and you're just wanting a touch of God. Don't let them pass by. Speak to him. Call on him. Say, Lord, come and help me tonight. So Paul and Silas and the mission team, they go through these towns and eventually they come to Thessalonica. You'll have heard of that name because there's two letters written in the New Testament to the church at Thessalonica. And the teams pay a very brief visit there, but we're not sure just how long it was. We are told that they were there for 3 Sabbath days. That would tell us they were there 3 weeks. So they were there at least 3 weeks. Maybe they didn't have the opportunity to go into the synagogue any more than 3 times, but they were forced to move on because of violent opposition from the Jews. However, in the short time that they were there, the impact that they had for God was absolutely huge. And in verses 1 to 4, Luke gives us a peek into Paul's approach to his preaching. Okay, so if we want to discover how to become effective at preaching, then the first 4 verses here can be very helpful because there are 5 words that are used. The first one is in verse number 3, that this Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah. So it was proclamation. They sounded out the message of the gospel of Jesus. Wherever they went, they proclaimed it. They didn't keep it to themselves. They sounded it out. You maybe remember that there used to be a band, it's still a hinking to go in Scotland, it's called the Proclaimers. I will walk 500 miles and so on. Yeah, and they became very famous for their passion and their singing. Well, Paul and his friends were proclaimers of the gospel, and they were famous for their passion to tell everybody about their Savior, Jesus Christ. And there's a sense in proclamation that the message that they gave was a very clear message. It was a message about the life and the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus and why he died and the wonderful hope that there is found when he has risen from the dead. The second word that we find here is in verse 2, that Paul reasoned from the scriptures. And there's a sense in which that word means it was a two-way thing. There was some arguing was done. And Paul was almost in a word fight with those who were there. Okay? He was reasoning with them. And so there's a sense in which there was a spiritual battle going on, particularly as he was speaking to the Jews. The third word that we have is he explained the word of God to them. He was opening the word of God. He was helping them to understand, in particular for the Jews, the Old Testament scriptures, so that they might see that the Messiah, who's promised in the Old Testament, had actually come in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. The other word that's used is he proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. And the fifth and final word that I could find here as Paul was preaching and proclaiming the gospel was this word, persuasion, in verse number 3. He persuaded people and he was convincing them to believe. And once they heard the message of the gospel, not only convincing them to believe, but actually to respond, to act on it, and take this step of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's part of our calling, to make Jesus known. It's to proclaim, to reason, to explain and prove and persuade people about Jesus. And of course, at the heart of that, it means that we need to know the gospel. We need to know the Word of God to be able to do all of these things. Let me encourage you to really grasp a hold of the Word of God. Read it regularly. Read it daily. Think about it. And particularly the gospel, so that we all might be effective in telling others about the Lord Jesus Christ. Testimony and knowledge of the Bible are essential tools for witnessing. But there is more to it than that. And for that, we need to journey forward into Paul's letter, first letter to the church in Thessalonica, which I think was probably written fairly soon after he had been there and left. And in verse number 5, it says this: our gospel came not simply with words, but also with power and with the Holy Spirit and deep conviction. Okay? So our words are important. Our ability to give other people the information about the gospel, to be persuasive, to reason with them, to proclaim it to them, to explain it. But it has to be more than that. It has to be accompanied by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And of course, when we step out for God to witness for him, then he comes and he touches people's hearts and he touches people's lives. Because at the end of the day, folks, it's not us that save people. It's God that saves people as he moves in their hearts and in their lives. And I can well remember back to when God started speaking to me he just brought me under conviction and I could not settle. I couldn't settle until I had made my decision one way or another. And I'm so glad tonight that after 3 weeks of wrestling and battling, I made the decision that I was going to ask the Lord Jesus into my life as my Savior. And it's been my privilege over the years, you know, when I've spoken to others about the gospel, having seen the times when I've seen before my very eyes, as I've been speaking to them, that God is working, he's opening their hearts to his word and to a knowledge of him. And it's really something special and exciting when that actually happens. And so a remarkable church is planted, and some were Jews. A large number were God-fearing Greeks. These weren't Jews. They were Gentile people. And quite a few prominent women believed as well. Today, I think we often feel that, you know, that the gospel is most effective when it's proclaimed to people who are actually poor and struggling and difficulties in their lives. But that's not always the case. And, you know, we find that in Paul and his mission journey, he spoke to business people who became Christians, prominent people who became Christians. And that tells us that the gospel is for everyone. The gospel really is for everyone. If we go to verse 9 of 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, it tells us a little bit about what happened in people's lives when they heard the word of God and when the Holy Spirit started to work it. Towards the end of verse 9, it says this: they turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath. And that helps us to understand the complete change around that happened in their lives. Here were people that worshipped idols, and that was very common in the ancient world. And particularly these Gentile people, they were worshipping idols, and then they heard about the living Lord Jesus and what he did on the cross, and they heard about the coming wrath of God. And they turned from their sin and they put their trust in Jesus and in his cross and in his blood that washes away our sins. And they came to faith in him. It was a complete U-turn in their lives, and something that would have been obvious within these cities. And I think that's what caused these places to be turned upside down for God, was the radical change that took place in the lives of those who put their faith in the Lord Jesus. And then we discover this, that they became imitators of Paul and Timothy and Silas. But more importantly, in verse 6 of 1 Thessalonians 1, they became imitators of the Lord, right? Now, at this time, we need to remember that the Gospels weren't written. And so they would have heard about the Lord Jesus through word of mouth. And I could imagine as they met up with Paul and Timothy and Silas, that these folks would say, "Tell us about Jesus. I want to know more about Jesus. Tell me what he said. Tell me what he did. Tell me how he lived, because we want to be like him. We want to follow in his footsteps." Isn't that exciting? I wonder really if that's our passion. Whether we maybe actually think about it. I want to be more like Jesus. The way he was. The way that he interacted with people. The way that he showed compassion to people. The way that he brought his healing and his comfort and his hope. The words that he spoke. The words that gave salvation and hope to people that had no hope at all. You know, we've got a most wonderful message. It's the greatest message that this world could ever possibly hear. And these folks in Thessalonica, they couldn't get enough of Jesus. And so they wanted to become imitators of him. They were also very well known for becoming missional. And Paul says this in verse 8, "The Lord's message rang out from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia. Your faith in God has become known everywhere." Isn't that remarkable? In a short space of time, they seem to have reached out with the gospel far and wide. So much was their love for Jesus and their passion for him. And they're in fact described by Paul in verse 7 as being a model church. So there's a lot that we can learn from the church in Thessalonica. And some of Paul's greatest teaching, especially about the return of the Lord Jesus, are in his letters that he wrote to the church in Thessalonica. And so they were planted and they were forged in the furnace of opposition and turmoil. We hear of that as these Jews came from Philippi and started to cause trouble once again. Paul and his friends seem to have managed to quietly disappear, but sadly for one man in particular, Jason, he got a bit of a hard time before he was he managed to pay some bail money and managed to be released again. So it can be dangerous to be a follower of Jesus. And Paul and Silas and Timothy and Luke quietly escape out of the city of Thessalonica, and they make their way further along to the next place, which is called Berea. And Berea is the last place that we are going to visit tonight. And as they always did, they go to the synagogue, the Jewish place of worship, to meet with the Jews there and to tell them about Jesus. And they get a much different reception in Berea than they did in Thessalonica. I want you to notice that the Bereans were really quite famous. And Paul said they were people of a much more noble character than those who were in Thessalonica. And the reason that they had such a noble character was because they received the message that Paul was preaching with great eagerness. They didn't reject it out of hand, as so many Jews did. They received it eagerly. They wanted to find out more They wanted to find out how Paul had come to that conclusion. I'm sure Paul told his testimony. He told his testimony a lot of how Jesus Christ, the risen Lord, had changed his life. But much more than that, he explained about the Messiah. He explained about the death and the resurrection of Jesus and the purpose of his death from the Old Testament scriptures. And we are told they examined the scriptures daily to test and prove Paul's message. Isn't that good? They didn't write it off. And I'm sure that Paul took them through so many of the Old Testament prophecies. Chapters like Isaiah, chapter 53. Places like Isaiah, chapter 9, where it speaks of the birth of the Lord Jesus. Chapter 53, which gives so much detail about the sufferings of the servant of God. And they became convinced that what Paul was preaching was true. And many of them gave their hearts and their lives to the Lord Jesus. And we are told that many Jews, many Greeks, and many prominent women believed. We sometimes get the idea that you know, that women were kept very much in the background in Old Testament, or in Bible times, in the ancient world. But as we read through the book of Acts, we discover that's not true. There were many prominent women. There were some women businessmen, as we discovered in Philippi when Paul encountered Lydia. And there was men, and there was women, there was Jews, there was Gentiles who came to put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the reality is the gospel is for everyone, young and old, no matter what nationality we are. We all need to hear it, and we all need to experience the salvation that Jesus brings. But what I just liked about Berea was the fact that they examined the scriptures. And I want to just challenge you and encourage you to read and to examine the scriptures every day as they did. Try and discover what it's about. And so often I speak to you and other people and they say the Old Testament's really hard. You know, I struggle to read the Old Testament. I want to encourage you to read the Old as well as the New Testament. I try and read through the Bible in a year, and it usually means reading two or three chapters of the Old Testament plus one chapter of the New Testament every day, and it takes you right through the whole Bible in a year. Because there's a thread that runs through the whole of the book of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. Yeah. It's God's rescue plan. And we see how God is working in people's lives. And you know, God records everything in his word. Warts and all. There's some stunningly awful stuff in the Bible. But these are things that actually happened. It's a Bible that's probably the greatest historic reference in the whole of the world. But more than that, it's the Bible is about God and his love for this world. Let me encourage you to read and understand his word, because when we do that, God plants his ways into our heart. I've told you this so often, I think. You know, he writes his laws on our heart. He makes us begin to think from his point of view instead of a worldly point of view. Yeah? And that can change everything. Learn to love the word of God. But learn to love the one that the word of God is about, Jesus Christ, as Savior and Lord. And when we take and treat God's word seriously, it has the effect of leading us to know and to grow. So be a person who wants to know and to grow. And that's where we're stopping tonight. And next week, I think we'll journey with, God willing, with Paul down to Athens. And exciting things happen in Athens as well. and we'll see how God is working in that great city.